Well, good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining us for this telephone town hall for parents, caregivers, and interested parties. I'm Andrew Enns with Leger, and I'll be your host this evening. There are a lot of respiratory viruses circulating in Manitoba right now, including seasonal flu, COVID-19, and respiratory syncytial virus, or RSV, as we've often come to learn about it in the media. This has led to a high number of kids coming to emergency departments and urgent care centers. If you're joining us tonight, it's likely because you have questions about prevention, how to care for your kids at home if they become sick, and when and where to take them for medical care. Tonight, we'll be hearing from Dr. Elizabeth Doyle, Medical Director and Section Head of Pediatric Emergency Medicine at HSC Children's, and Dr. Brent Rusin, no stranger to most, I don't think, Chief Provincial Public Health Officer. They're going to provide some opening remarks, and then we're going to start taking your questions. Some have been collected in advance, but please, this is a great opportunity for you to ask a couple of the top medical professionals in the province a question. If you have a question, let us know by pressing the asterisk or star key and then 3 at any time, star 3. Someone from our team will gather a bit of information from you, and you may be chosen to ask your question live during our town hall. Later on, we'll be also putting up a couple of poll questions to learn more about where you get information about caring for your kids when they're sick. So start thinking a bit about that, and I'll have those questions for you soon, a little bit later in this call. Now I'm going to turn things over to Dr. Doyle. And remember, if you have a question for us, please press star 3. Dr. Doyle?
Thank you, Andrew, and good evening, everyone. I'm very delighted to be here tonight to answer questions and offer some advice to parents, guardians, and other caregivers that are caring for sick children. I want to acknowledge up front that having a sick child at home can be scary and it can be overwhelming. Many parents and caregivers are tired and stressed as their children become ill with more frequency than in the past. And our goal tonight is to provide some education and a little reassurance to everyone. So let me give you some background. So the care teams in Children's Emergency have been seeing many kids experiencing flu-like symptoms. A number of them are actually testing positive for multiple viruses at the same time, including influenza A, respiratory syncytial virus, or RSV, and COVID-19. We're used to seeing flu and other respiratory viruses like RSV in the winter, but the difference this year is the timing. All of these viruses are coming at once and they're coming earlier than we normally have them. Throughout the pandemic, they were kept at bay in large part because of all of the things we were doing to protect ourselves and those around us. Now that we're back to largely doing things the way we once did, the viruses have had an opportunity to spread again, and they are doing so all at once. So it's understandable that many of you may have questions about when you need to take your child to an emergency department, what circumstances may be better for you to see your family doctor or a walk-in clinic, and what can be managed at home. And that's why we're encouraging you to take the time to understand where to take your child when they're sick and how some trips to healthcare facilities can be avoided altogether with preventative measures. I wanted to make a little comment about fever and Tylenol. I just wanted to remind parents that the common cold and flu can be safely managed at home with rest and fluids by keeping cool, comfortably unbundling your children, giving cool beverages. Fever in itself is not dangerous. It's the body's natural response to infection and does not typically require treatment with medicine. We do know that there are supply chain issues, and hopefully that will be behind us soon. But for the moment, we have released advice for parents on how to safely split adult medications like Tylenol for use if necessary. And you can find this and other useful information about caring for your child at kidcaremb.ca. So how about when to come to Children's Emergency? Children's Emergency addresses the most serious and life-threatening health issues. All children who come to the emergency department are assessed, they're triaged upon arrival, and care is provided with the sickest and most injured patients prioritized. For people coming to the emergency care for minor illnesses, a low-grade fever, a rash, they may wait typically much longer than they would at a walk-in clinic or an urgent care. But we want to be clear that the Children's Emergency Department is always here for you and your children, and we will always ensure that your kids get the care they need. So while we have this respiratory illness in high amount in the community, please call 911 or come to the emergency department if your child has the following symptoms: difficulty breathing, periods of holding your breath, not breathing, slowed breathing, rapid breathing. If your child is excessively sleepy or difficult to wake up, if your child experiences sudden confusion, a change in the color of the nail beds, hands, lips, or face, crying that won't stop, is painful sounding or is inconsolable, your child is not peeing, your child is feeding poorly, or you have an infant that is less than 3 months of age with a fever. There's a number of things we can all do to help mitigate the spread of viruses so that less children become sick and need to seek care in any setting. I'll turn this discussion over to Dr. Brent Rusin to provide some of those details.
Thanks for that, Dr. Doyle. Okay, now let's hear from Dr. Rusin. And just a reminder, folks, I know I see a few questions showing up in the queue, but we're still taking some questions, so please press *3 if you have a question for us, and we'll start into those right away after we hear from Dr. Rusin.
Well, thanks. Good evening, everyone. Brent Rusin here, Manitoba's Chief Provincial Public Health Officer. Thanks for joining us. We're definitely seeing high levels of respiratory virus activity right now in the province. This includes RSV, influenza, COVID, and so certainly we see these viruses in the past, but as we just heard, we're seeing them earlier and to much greater degree, and they're all occurring at the same time. So it's putting a tremendous strain right now on kids and our healthcare system. So we just heard a lot of good advice on things to look for and how we can manage these children depending on their level of severity. So I want to focus on a bit of the prevention side of things, what we can do to prevent some of these infections. And so we've learned over the last number of years a number of things that we can do to help protect ourselves and the people around us. And so I want to start with one of the most important things, and that's vaccine. So we know that influenza vaccine, the seasonal flu vaccine, is safe, it's effective. We know that there's a reported good match this year with the virus and what's included in the vaccine. And so we know that this is a tremendous way to protect ourselves and the people around us. So all children 6 months and up can get the flu vaccine. And so it's especially important to those under five, those at the extremes of age, those caring for those individuals. So pregnant females or those caring for younger children are strongly advised to get this influenza vaccine as soon as they can. We know that this is a lot of access to this vaccine right now. You can call your primary care provider, call pharmacists, you can attend one of the public health run clinics, go online to our vaccine finder, and there's many opportunities to receive these vaccines. We know that right now in those children under five, we only see about 6% of those children with an influenza shot this year, so we'd really like to see that really get increased in a short amount of time. So really think about getting those youngsters vaccinated as soon as possible. We know we have COVID vaccines. And so again, those children 6 months and older are eligible to receive a COVID vaccine. Those over age 12 can get a bivalent vaccine at this point. And certainly we encourage that for all Manitobans over age 12 to get that fall booster bivalent dose. So again, in those youngsters, we're not seeing the greatest amount of uptake of those COVID vaccines either. And so seeing all the virus being transmitted right now, we really want to focus on vaccines. Those are really one of the best ways to protect ourselves and the people around us. So do try to find a place to get these vaccines, your primary care provider, pharmacist, or public health clinic. The other thing that we've learned a lot about this these last few years is staying home when we're sick. And so we know that to prevent transmission of these viruses, it's best really to stay home when we're feeling ill. And we know in the past, pre-pandemic, we've all pushed out a cold or a flu at work or sent our children to school when they're feeling unwell, but we know that those times have changed. We need people to stay home when they're feeling unwell to stop or at least prevent some of that spread of these viruses. We know a lot of other things about infection prevention. We've been washing our hands more than ever, using hand sanitizer, and we certainly don't want to stop doing that. We need to continue to cough or sneeze into our sleeve if possible. And also, when we're seeing such a high rate of viral transmission, when we're in indoor public places, it's also a good idea to be wearing masks. And so we can wear a well-fitted mask indoor public places, especially when it's crowded, especially in poorly ventilated areas. We should all be considering wearing that that mask as well at these times. Also, you know, reach out if you have questions. Your primary care provider is there for you. Pharmacists are there. Public health is there. We know we have Health Links, Info Santé. So there's lots of people to reach out to if you have any questions going forward. But remember those layers of protection that we have that we can all work on together. One, getting vaccinated is the most important thing. Staying home when ill, washing our hands, coughing into the sleeve, and wearing a mask in indoor public places, especially when it's crowded and poorly ventilated. So thanks again for joining us. They're really looking forward to answering some of your questions, and I'm going to turn it back to the moderator.
Well, thank you, Dr. Rusin, and both doctors from a lot of good information there. You know, Dr. Rusin, I just wanted to follow up quickly on something on the preventative side, because one of our online messages that came in asked that in addition to the vaccines and things like that and the flu shot, are there any sort of dietary or vitamin or supplemental things that parents can do to try to build up the immune system for their child?
You know, so I think that we know that there's many things that keep us healthy, and so I wouldn't comment on any, say, specific type of vitamins or supplements, but that healthy diet with the fresh fruits and veggies, ensuring we're getting enough sleep, staying active, these are all important things for overall health.
Excellent. Thank you. So a question we've got, and I'm going to direct this to you, Dr. Doyle. You know, probably can't go a day without hearing a little bit about the wait times and the ERs in particular. I know in your neck of the woods it's quite busy. Is there any advice you have for parents in terms of like when they need to really bring their child into an ER? It's a very tough situation, I'm sure, but anything you can share with folks? It was a question that came in.
Yeah, absolutely, and especially with the respiratory season being here, I think there's some very specific things that would suggest that a child needs to come to an emergency. So anytime you see your child having difficulty breathing, so that may mean the little nose is flaring, they may be sucking in between their ribs, they may be engaging their tummy muscles, if their color is poor, if they're having pauses in their breathing, especially with our young infants, that is a reason to come to the emergency department. If your child is not drinking enough to pee more than 3 diapers in 24 hours, that is a reason to come. If your child is so sleepy that they won't wake up and does not seem to recognize you or seems to be confused in any way, that's a reason to come. If your child is less than 3 months and has a fever, we should see you, okay? If your child has a rash that looks like bruises that don't go away when you press down on them, we need to see them. If your child is sleepy and has significant neck pain and is having trouble looking at the lights and is vomiting, we need to see you. So those would be some of the suggested during the respiratory season to come. There's other reasons, you know, associated with injury, but I think we'll focus this
talk
on respiratory.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much for that. You know, and another question, you know, Dr. Russo, I'm going to ask this of you because you spoke a great deal about the importance of vaccines and flu shots. What's your sense what's the best approach for parents in terms of trying to get more than one shot at the same time with their young child? Is there some advice there you can share?
Yeah, it's a really good question. So typically our advice is we want children to be up to date on all their vaccines if they're eligible as soon as possible. And so children can certainly receive more than one immunization at a time. And if they're due for more than one at the same time, we strongly encourage them to get all of the vaccines, in fact, that they're due for at that time. So the immune system is very, very robust. There's no concern about overwhelming with these vaccines. So we really encourage those children to get up to date on as many vaccines as possible as soon as possible.
Okay, thank you for that, Doctor. I'm going to go to the phone lines, actually. We have a question from Tanya from Selkirk, and her question relates to the contagious period of the RSV. I won't try to say that again, actually. So I'm going to bring this in. Tanya, are you there?
I am.
Please ask the question to the doctors, please.
Okay, I have two questions. With this respiratory season, are you finding that we can get RSV more than once in this season? And then also, how long is it contagious for in respect to going back to daycare and things like that?
Great question, Sonia. Thank you very much for those.
Yeah, so it would be unlikely to get RSV twice in one season, but what you may be seeing is bronchiolitis caused by two different viruses. So one of the viruses may be RSV, but perhaps the other virus is influenza causing bronchiolitis, or it is adenovirus causing bronchiolitis. So that is a possibility.
Okay. I'm going to go to Amanda in Winnipeg. Dr. Rusin, again, sort of relates to what you were talking about, the flu shot. She's just wondering about sort of access and more availability. Amanda, are you there with your question? Hi, Amanda, are you there with your question?
Yes, we were trying to access, we've been looking for the flu shot since September, family doctor, multiple pharmacies. Was there a delay in getting it out? Is it there now? I'll try the vaccine finder. I did hear you mention that, so that's helpful.
Yeah, right. Yeah, for sure. Yeah, so absolutely. Try the vaccine finder. There's hundreds of thousands of doses out right now in the communities. Yeah, pharmacy, primary care, as well as public health clinics. So there's lots of vaccine available. So do call around. Do use that vaccine finder. And we really, there's a lot of people out there happy to give that to you.
Terrific. Thank you, Dr. Reason. I think, some of those questions regarding sort of information, probably a good time to ask our poll question of you, the listeners on the call. And we're interested in understanding where you get your information in terms of caring for your sick child. So the question is, where are you most likely to get information about how to care for your sick child? Press 1 if it's the HealthLinks Info Santé. Press 2 if it's the Public Health Office. Press 3 on your phone if it's a doctor or a pediatrician. Press 4 for a pharmacist. Press 5 if you look on social media. Press 6 if it's Healthy Parenting Winnipeg. Press 7 if it's online parenting groups. Press 8 if it's online searches. Or press 9 if you don't seek out information from any of these sources. I see some answers coming in. Looks like the doctor pediatrician is about a little under half of the responses. Certainly coming in. None of these is online searches is fairly high. Be curious about that for sure. It's interesting. So I guess a question while we're waiting for these responses to come in, I was going to ask you, Dr. Doyle, what's your recommendation for a parent in terms of if their young infant has a fever at home? Do they attempt to treat that, or is there some advice regarding that in terms of course of action?
Absolutely, absolutely. So a couple of points about that and treating fevers. So first of all, as we had mentioned before, fever is not dangerous. So there's many ways that we can address fever in a young infant without giving medication for that. We can comfortably undress them. We can offer, you know, breastfeeding or fluids very frequently. We can run a fan. Those kinds of things will all be helpful in terms of reducing the temperature for a young infant. Now, if the infant is irritable and not wanting to feed and you really feel that you need to give something, then obviously when the supply chain issue was not an issue, then we would give Tylenol or we would give some ibuprofen. Right now, the supply chain issue is a problem, and we unfortunately cannot use our instructions to crush adult Tylenol and ibuprofen for the very young infant, because you can imagine crushing a pill into an eighth is a very challenging thing to do and may result in inappropriate dosing of the infant. Okay, so in that sort of scenario, you'll want to go to a compounding pharmacist who can actually do this and change it into a suspension, which he can then dispense to you. And there's a few compounding pharmacies in Winnipeg that you may use. Another very important thing to emphasize, if your child is 3 months of age and younger and has a fever, the child should be seen as well by a medical professional. Yeah, I would recommend having your child seen in emergency in that scenario.
Excellent. Thank you. Thank you for that. I'm going to just move to our second poll question. It's really a carbon copy of the first, but it's sort of still digging a little deeper into those sources of information for you as parents and caregivers when you're looking for information for your sick child. So, you know, you've answered, you know, where you most likely got information, and now where else would you go for information? And again, the answer choices are HealthLinks, InfoSante. You press one on your phone. The public health office, press two. A doctor or pediatrician, press three. Pharmacist, press four. Social media, press five. Healthy Parenting Winnipeg, press six. Online parenting groups, press seven. Online searches, press eight. Or none of these, press nine. So again, just where, you know, where would the next most likely source for information that you would turn to for information about caring for your sick child? We'll see those results come in, and I'm going to line up something here on the on two. Yeah, I guess one, and I've seen this question come up and Dr. Doyle, this might be another one for you, but how does a parent distinguish between RSV and a cold? Mm-hmm. Is there certain telltale symptoms that they can latch on to?
Yeah, so I think what we're trying to distinguish more is RSV bronchiolitis versus a cold, because RSV can cause a common cold. It can cause pneumonia, viral pneumonia, or it can cause bronchiolitis, which is when it attacks the small airways of the lungs, it causes some narrowing of those small airways or bronchioles and causes bronchiolitis. When they have bronchiolitis, they have often wheezing. So you may hear wheezing, you may see some difficulty breathing, you may see them have some difficulty with feeding. And that is, you know, so if RSV is just causing the common cold, the answer is you can't distinguish the two. It's only when it proceeds to involve the small airways of the lungs, and then you can say that that's bronchiolitis.
Great. I've got, I'm going to go to our phone lines again, and Dr. Rusin, this might be a question for you. There's a question regarding the wait time between vaccines. So I'm going to bring in Delta from Waterhen with your question. Delta, are you there?
I am. Dr. Rusin, is there a recommended time in between receiving vaccines and another shot, for example, like shingles?
Mm-hmm. Well, right. Really good question. So, you know, for the most part, it's going to depend a bit on the specific vaccine. So you can ask sort of, specifics to a healthcare provider. For the most part,
You know, any vaccines can be received at the same time together for a very few what we call the live vaccines, so measles, mumps, rubella, any of these live vaccines, then we do want to have a waiting period of 4 weeks. But for the most part, any of these ones, COVID vaccine, influenza, these are all inactivated vaccines, so we don't really have any time in between different vaccines for it. So for specific questions, always best to run it by, you know, a healthcare provider, just in case, depending on which vaccine you got. For the most part, these vaccines can all be done at the same time, and very few require any waiting period between them.
Excellent. Great. Thank you for that. I've got a question here from Nita, and it sort of talks to the notion of when a viral infection might become a bacterial infection. Nita, I'm going to ask you to ask your question to Dr. Doyle.
Hi, thank you. So I'm just wondering, at what point should we be concerned about a viral infection turning into a bacterial, and what are some of the signs for that? And also, when do antibiotics come into play?
Mm-hmm. Yes, so thank you for that question. So a couple of comments first. So when we're talking about a bacterial infection complicating a viral infection, so it doesn't turn into a bacterial infection, but it can be complicated by a viral infection, by a bacterial infection, there's a couple of things that can happen. One is you can get a bacterial pneumonia with these respiratory processes. You might get an ear infection that might be heralded by increased pain in the ear. But often when we're moving in that direction where it's no longer influenza, no longer RSV, but something more, usually we see a spike in the temperature. So things are, you know, maybe grumbling along and maybe getting a little bit better. All of a sudden there's a new fever that comes up, or a new symptom. So pain in the chest for pneumonia, there might be ear pain for an ear infection. And so at that point, you know, having a look and seeing if there is signs and symptoms that are consistent with those bacterial infections may be an indication for antibiotic at that point in time. The tricky part about influenza is, with influenza, you are sick for a long time. So influenza A typically causes a fever and symptoms for 5 to 7 days. And so that is long. People are used to having, you know, viruses by 72 hours, people are on the mend. And the difference with influenza is that it does last a lot longer. And I think that's very hard, you know, for most people to watch and to think that this could still be viral. But in fact, it is.
Excellent. Thank you. You know, Dr. Rusin, I won't, we have a number of questions on regarding, you know, parents asking about masks. So I noticed one, there was a teacher talking about some absenteeism in her class. And you know, I wonder, can you speak to that? It's obviously an issue on the top, and it's also, I see some questions in terms of you know, some comments not wanting a mask. Can you maybe speak to where we're at currently on that, and sort of any of any thoughts regarding that?
Yeah, and I think to address the question regarding masks, you have to go back to the multiple layers that we can take to protect ourselves, right? So so we want those vaccines up to date, staying home when ill, washing our hands, proper cough hygiene, and then wearing a mask in indoor public places, especially crowded or poorly ventilated, is another a good option for people. We were certainly not going to be mandating it. We were giving it as advice for people to consider. And we know that wearing that mask won't be done in all places where viruses are transmitted, right? So certainly in gatherings and private gatherings, there can be transmission, you know, in cars. So there's a number of places where transmission can occur. So it's way better to use these multiple layers of protection, which can include wearing a mask in many circumstances.
Excellent. Thank you. Yeah, it's a tough topic, and it will continue to be, I'm sure. I've got one here from Ittorio. Hopefully I'm getting that name right. Ittorio, you have a question regarding a fever, a particular temperature fever. Ittorio, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Please ask your question to Dr. Doyle.
Thank you. My question is, Dr. Darrow did mention that fever is not dangerous. So if a child should have a fever that is as high as 40 degrees, do I still manage that at home, or is it something I should panic?
Yeah, thank you for the question. It's a really good question and a very common question that we are asked, actually. So the actual height of the fever does not dictate how serious the child is ill. So if a child has a temperature of 40 degrees and you know, comfortably undress him and he cools off maybe to 39, 38, he's able to drink, he's active, he has no other concerning features of difficulty breathing or dehydration or anything like that, then yes, that child can stay home with a 40 degree temperature. But if I have a child who has a 38 degree temperature, but the child is working hard to breathe, is dehydrated, I want to see that child before I want to see the child who's got a temperature of 40 degrees. So it's the associated symptoms with the fever that become more important in terms of determining whether that child needs to be seen. Okay.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you for that. I've got a question here, and I think I'm going to address this to Dr. Rusin. And it's Kelly with a two-year-old daughter who just recovered from COVID and is wondering about the applicability of getting the flu shot. Kelly, are you there to ask your question?
Yes, I am. She did have COVID a couple of weeks ago, and she's sick again, and I feel like illness is just cycling through our house, and I don't necessarily know what she has now. And so I'm wondering, if I don't know if she's had the flu, is it still okay to get a flu shot?
Yeah, absolutely. So so certainly the you know, flu shot, barring any other reasons why a child couldn't get it, allergy or previous you know, reaction, anything like that, then yes. So I wouldn't assume any of the previous infections were flu. And when she's recovered, then certainly would be eligible to get the flu vaccine. And if one of those illnesses happen to be the flu without us knowing, that doesn't increase risk or any harm. So I wouldn't avoid getting that flu shot just because you think someone may have had the flu.
Excellent. Thank you, Dr. Rusin. I'm going to bring in Linda from who's got a question regarding actually just over-the-counter meds and sort of some shortages that I have a feeling a few parents are running into. Linda from Winnipeg, are you there to ask your question to Dr. Doyle?
Yeah, hi.
Hello.
My question is regarding, well, I guess to do with the supply chain shortage of the children's fever-reducing medicines. I was recently prescribed a cough syrup by my doctor, and the pharmacy called me to advise that cough medicine was not available. No substitutes were available, and they had no idea when they would become available. So is this going to affect children? I'd also heard that amoxicillin was possibly going to be in the shortage too. So I'm just wondering how the supply chain things are going to affect all of us, I guess, not just children, but adults too.
Mm-hmm. So that's a very good question and a question a lot of people are asking. Specific to cough syrups and cough medicine, I want to address that right now because that is not something that we recommend in children at all. No over-the-counter cough syrups or medication. The only thing that is recommended is pasteurized honey or natural honey in terms of helping with cough. So there's a lot of side effects from over-the-counter cough preparations and medications, and so we do not recommend that for children at all. Okay. With respect to the rest of the supply chain issues, amoxicillin is not something that we're worried about at the moment. And you've heard already about the Tylenol and the ibuprofen, which look like we're going to be getting some supply soon. And we've had some measures to use some adult preparations to formulate, you know, Tylenol and ibuprofen for kids in the meantime. But in terms of anything else that's really relevant for kids, you know, allergy medications are okay so far. You know, inhalers are okay so far. You know, I'm trying to think of things that are specific to the respiratory illnesses, but those would be the main things, and I don't think you need to worry about those.
Great, thank you for that. Dr. Roos, I'm going to bring in you with a question, and it's Adebisi has got a question. It's specific to the infant, trying to prevent her infant or infant getting RSVP, but I have a feeling there might be some broader advice you could share in terms of just keeping, you know, our infants out there protected. Adebisi, I apologize if I'm making a mess of the name, but if you're there, please ask your question to Dr. Roosen.
Okay, yeah, thank you. Adebisi is the actually pronounced as well. So my kid had the respiratory virus, because he had diarrhea for like a couple of days, but it stopped already. So I don't know if it's the respiratory virus, and I also have a baby, a 6-month-old baby, so I don't want him transmitting that to the baby, so I don't know how to prevent that, because I can't handle a baby having diarrhea. So, yeah, and again, I also want to ask if we can get a flu shot as well, because he just recovered from the diarrhea.
All right. Okay. Yeah. Well, good. Some good questions there. And this is what we see, right? We see multiple viruses right now, and we know that in that household setting, these can spread quite easily. So, if we're speaking about a diarrheal illness, you know, number one ahead of everything is hand washing. Hand washing very frequently, especially after every diaper change. Lots of using household cleaners in the washroom and where this changing came from. And that's really the best thing is lots of hand washing with everyone in that household constantly. You know, respiratory illness is much, much more difficult to prevent, but hand washing is good. The respiratory etiquette we spoke about is a good coughing into the sleeve, these type of things. And then as far as the flu shot, yeah, so as long as the child is fully recovered and feeling well, then I would encourage getting that that flu shot.
Excellent. Thank you for that, Dr. Roosen. I'm going to turn to Kim. Kim, you have a question regarding the RSV vaccine and wondering how widely it can be provided to people. Kim, if you're there, please jump in with your question.
Yes, I'm just wondering, I know the RSV vaccine has been around for quite a number of years, and it was generally only offered to premature babies and children who were at high risk. If we're in such a concern with the numbers of patients coming in and the number of kids coming in and being admitted, why are we not offering that vaccine to the those most at risk, likely those under 18 months of age? Why is it not being offered to that general population?
Yeah, Kim, thank you for the question. You know, it's a question we've asked for many, many years right now, but the reality is that the high-risk groups are those that you were mentioning just now, so the preemies, the kids with underlying conditions like congenital heart or chronic lung, or they have an immune problem. Most other kids recover very, very well with this illness, and even if they're in hospital for a short period of time, they do recover well. We're not certain about, you know, in terms of the vaccine, it's actually prophylaxis that's given, how feasible that would be. So if you understand how it's given, so generally it's an injection that's given once a month through the RSV season to those at-risk groups. So starting in November and going all the way until December, January, the children would get like a vaccine a month, like an injection, an IV injection once a month, right? And so that's a big deal. And the question becomes really, do we need to do it, right?
Fair enough. Thank you. Thank you for that. Mm-hmm. Dr. Roosen, a question that I imagine, and again, this is another one that's come up a few times and probably on the mind of a lot of parents. And it's from Linda in Linda, and it involves the when is it safe for your child to return to daycare or school after they've had some illness that they've had to deal with. Linda, are you there with your question?
Yeah, I am here with my question. I work in a daycare, and it's like a revolving door right now of children coming in sick and going home and coming back sick. When is it safe for them to come back? Because it's like no sooner one comes back in, the whole daycare gets sick or the staff are sick. So when should they stay home, or and when could they come back?
Yeah, and so we're definitely seeing this in lots mm-hmm. of settings, but certainly daycares this time of year and especially this season. So, the biggest issue there is symptoms. So, staying home when sick is the biggest thing to keep in mind. So as soon as any symptoms start developing, we want the kiddos to stay home for that. If it's a respiratory virus that we have no diagnosis for, then staying home until improving. So certainly no fever, and clearly improving for a couple of days. So it doesn't mean they have to be totally asymptomatic, but they should be obviously getting better for a couple of days and then heading back. We still have the advice specifically for COVID that should be at least 5 days. So at least 5 days, no fever, and continuing and clearly getting better.
Great. Thank you for that good advice, Dr. Rusin. Andrea in Winnipeg has a question regarding RSV and sort of its severity, but also sort of the long-term implications. Andrea, are you there with your question to Dr. Doyle? Oh, maybe not. Andrea? Might have lost her, but I guess that is a question. Obviously with COVID, we've seen some conversations and some issues with long COVID. Are there some issues with RSV in terms of some long-term concerns that parents should be alert to?
So most of the time I would say absolutely not. Most children will recover from RSV. When you should start to worry, if the RSV is causing a pneumonia or a bronchiolitis, the child is having difficulty breathing, the child is not feeding, the child has poor color, those would be indications to be seen, and it may indicate that things are worsening for that child. Sometimes those children just need some oxygen, some suction, some IV fluids, but sometimes they do need help in terms of breathing. So they need, ventilation, they have a breathing tube that's put in, or they have a very high flow oxygen given. So those things do happen, but virtually all of these children recover. It's very rare to see RSV become chronic. When it does, there's usually something else underlying. So it's usually our children who have an underlying condition already. And so that's a little bit of a different population, but our otherwise healthy children almost all recover.
Okay. We've got an online question came in that I thought is somewhat, I'm not sure who would take this, but it relates to the bivalent booster. Before they had the booster before their newborn was born. Would any protection against RSV been passed on to the newborn as a result of getting the booster shot, prior to delivery?
So, if the question is about RSV, then no, that bivalent vaccine doesn't protect against RSV. Is there some protection, depending if mom had been exposed to RSV, sometimes maternal antibodies are passed on through birth or breastfeeding, but certainly the bivalent vaccine doesn't protect against the RSV.
Okay. And there's another question that came in on the online portal was how best to treat fevers that aren't responding to sort of some of the traditional over-the-counter Advils and Tylenols. Any advice there, Dr. Doyle?
So I think one of the things that it is important to do is to manage expectations. So when a child has a fever, we shouldn't expect that any medication or any intervention is going to take away that fever right away or completely. And that is particularly true when we're talking about influenza A. So in children who have influenza A, you know, if you were to give Tylenol or ibuprofen in that setting, you might see a small drop in the fever. The child might be a little bit more comfortable, but it's unlikely that you're going to break that fever for the first 2 to 3 days. You may not get it to normal during that entire time, and that's okay. So the, you know, managing that expectation of not needing to get that temperature normalized. Remember, we talked about how fever is not dangerous, and that allowing the children to experience fever is actually okay.
Okay, thank you for that. I'm going to bring in a question in from one of our callers, and I think Dr. Doyle, this might be in your neck of the woods, because it's just a question about more about the system in terms of, you know, the number of children. We hear lots of news regarding the number of children being admitted into hospital, but is there sort of a, how long are they in for normally, and is there sort of, you know, some news in terms of, or, you know, staff being sent home, you know, and children being sent home? Crystal, I think this was your question, and if you're there still on the line, please present your question to Dr. Doyle.
I'm here, thank you. Yes, as you said, we hear about astounding numbers of children visiting Children's Hospital and enduring long wait times each day. So I'm wondering whether there's much or any data available about the number of children who are being treated or admitted versus those who are being sent home and just recommend they take fever-reducing medication where no hospital care really needed to be provided. So as a follow-up question, will there be any further public campaign to help reduce the number of unnecessary visits, especially for children over age one, to help take some of the burden off our healthcare system and the hardworking frontline workers?
Absolutely, absolutely. So I can tell you that there's been over 100 children seen with RSV through the Children's Emergency, and then 34 of those kids have been admitted, 22 in the last week, and 3 of those have been admitted to PICU. So I would have to say that the majority, so 2/3 of children who are being seen are actually seen and discharged home. And then about 1/3 is being admitted. When they're admitted, sometimes it's for a very brief period of time, and the amount of oxygen that they're requiring is very, very small, actually. So the kids who are admitted to our general wards are generally not very sick, but they do need a little bit of oxygen to support for a couple of days.
Great. Thank you. Thank you for that. Dr. Doyle, I guess Jacinta has a question in Winnipeg, and I think this might still be for you, Dr. Doyle, in terms of how many symptoms do children, you know, need to have present to indicate they need medical attention? And I think it touches on something maybe you talked about earlier in terms of just generally, you know, that trip to the ER or to your doctor. Jacinta, are you still with us?
Yes, I am. Yeah, thanks for having me. This question stems from a recent experience at daycare. My child was recovering from a cough, and then I was called to come pick her up and go have her tested for RSV. But that was about the only symptom that she had. So I'm wondering how many of these symptoms or how serious do these symptoms need to get for us to actually take these kids in to have them check if it's actually RSV?
Yes, so good question. And again, what you're going to use as your barometer is what other symptoms that they have associated, okay? So with RSV, if they have a little bit of a cough and a little bit of a runny nose, but they're otherwise well, they're not having difficulty breathing, they're not having difficulty feeding to the point of becoming dehydrated, they have good color, then your child does not need to seek medical attention in that scenario. If your child does have some of those symptoms, difficulty breathing, pauses in breathing, poor color, is dehydrated, then that is an indication to have that child seen.
Great, great, good stuff. I've got a question, and I think maybe Dr. Rusin, I might get you to weigh in on this in terms of, again, just helping parents understand some of those contagious periods for some of these infections. And Roberta, this is a question you had. So if you're still with us, please ask your question to Dr. Rusin.
Hi.
Hi, Roberta.
Hi. I actually, there was a lady that had asked it in the beginning, but she had asked a few questions, so it kind of got maybe missed. Just how long that contagious period is for these viruses, and I know you had kind of touched on how long they should be staying home as if they have no fever and their symptoms are getting better. I do notice with my children, they still are coughing quite a bit even after that 5-6 days. So, yeah, just how long they are contagious, and is it appropriate to be sending them still back with a bit of a cough?
Yeah, and it's a good question. It's a tough thing this time of year with so many people ill and staying home when they're sick, and so for the most part, we're talking about symptoms here. So you know, staying home at the first sign of illness is vital. And then for the most part, as time goes on, we become less and less infectious for these things. And so there's no, on-off switch, but things like certainly no fever and significant improvement for a couple days are all indicators that there's less and less risk of infection there. So that's sort of that best advice, that stay home when ill, certainly the fever resolved, and a couple days of quite significant improvement in symptoms, then it's very likely that they're less and less infectious at that point. So we're not saying everyone has to be completely asymptomatic before they return, because sometimes, like you say, that can last weeks, sometimes with a dry cough after an infection, but certainly no fever and significant improvement after a number of days.
Excellent. Thank you, Dr. Rusin. A question that, came up in terms of, the Tylenol dosage, but I think you talked about this in terms before, Dr. Doyle, in terms of really anything with a six-month-old or younger, really nothing suitable, right? Excellent. Okay. I'm going to ask Valencia from Winnipeg to ask her question. She's got a question regarding the COVID vaccine, but she's still feeling a bit sick. So maybe, Valencia, are you able to add a little bit to that, to your question there on in terms of safety of getting the COVID vaccine for your daughter? Hold on. Let's get rid of that. There we go. Are you there with us, Valencia?
Yes. Yes, I'm here.
Great.
So she has been sick multiple times since October 15th with a high fever and coughing. So in the end, she got diagnosed with pneumonia. So she was in two different doses of antibiotic because the first one doesn't work. The second one doesn't work. So she tested negative for COVID. So my question is, the only things that she lack of is right now is a COVID vaccine. She's on, like, she had her flu vaccine this year and then everything. So when is it safe for her to get a COVID vaccine that where she is still battling the virus? She's having fever. This is the third time now.
Oh, right. Yeah, great question. Yeah, so we do, want her to get that COVID shot when she's feeling better. So, we should avoid giving a shot when someone's having a fever or is acutely ill. So once that fever's gone and she's, recovered from this illness, then yes, that COVID shot is a good idea.
Great. Thank you for that question, Valencia. I've got one in on the from the online side. May Dr. Doyle ask you this. At what point should a parent seek medical advice with a persistent cough? We haven't really talked too much about the cough side, lots of fever. So.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So when children get ill, it's not uncommon for them to continue to cough, especially with a virus, for up to 3 weeks after the onset. And so unless there are other things associated during that period, like a new fever, difficulty breathing, pus coming out of the nose to suggest a sinus infection or something like that, then we generally do not treat any cough. After 3 weeks, we start to think about things. Could this be related to asthma? Could this be allergies? Those kinds of things. So the answer is up to 3 weeks.
Okay. And another question from the online side of things relates to RSV, which I think is probably one of those new things that probably a lot of us didn't know was around prior, you know, all of a sudden, you know, post-COVID now. How do they test for RSV? And is there, are there some guidelines or some information based strictly on that? Like there was for COVID, there seemed to be a lot of information and background material in terms of how to deal with, how to recognize it. Is there anywhere where parents can find that kind of information?
Absolutely, absolutely. So there are many, many evidence-based websites that parents can use. One of them is our local TREC.ca, which is Translating Emergency Knowledge for Kids. There's some good information there on RSV. There's also the Caring for Kids website on by the Canadian Pediatric Society, and you can go straight in that on your internet. And that is a very reliable site as well in terms of RSV. The first part of the question was testing for it. So the testing is actually done as a nasal swab as well, just like COVID. And in fact, right now, the most common swab we do is what we call a triple swab, and we test for COVID, influenza, and RSV together. We're usually not doing those swabs unless the children are admitted to hospital. Okay? Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Well, look, we're reaching near the top of the top of the hour. I did. We've had a lot of great questions. I know there's still a few in the queue, although we have worked through quite a few. But I'd like to, first of all, thank you both very much for the time you've given tonight. I think you've shared some really good information. But you know, maybe give you an opportunity for a few last comments in terms of to wrap things up, and then we'll say goodnight to the good folks on the call. But Dr. Doyle, any last sort of bit of advice or some, I know you talked about some information sources. I don't think you can say that enough. So.
Mm-hmm. No, absolutely. But I wanted to mention again the idea of fever and the fact that it's really not dangerous and that the absolute height of the fever is not what's important, but all of the other symptoms that are associated with that. Those are two key messages I really want to get out there. And also the indications for bringing a child back to emergency. So difficulty breathing or pauses in breathing, poor color, signs of dehydration, those would be indications for coming to emergency with a respiratory illness. Okay. Some of the websites we talked about, the Caring for Kids, the TREC.ca, and the KidCare, which is a new website that's just been up recently and has some shared health information all the way from management of fever to when to go and where to go in terms of seeking care, and also, resources in terms of Tylenol, crushing adult Tylenol and Advil for use in younger children.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Dr. Rusin, any last pieces of advice for Manitobans on the phone?
Yeah, and thanks again for everyone for joining us. Mm-hmm. I know we've just come across some couple rough years and then into a real tough respiratory virus season. And so just sort of reminding everyone that there are a number of things we can do to protect ourselves and the people around us, right? We spoke about those a lot today. Vaccine, those kids 6 months and older can get both influenza and the COVID vaccine. So really encourage high uptake for that. We know we need to stay home when we're sick. We need to stop and minimize the transmission of these viruses, and that happens when we're symptomatic. So if we stay home when we're sick, we're going to be helping people around us as well. And then those things like coughing, sneezing into our sleeve, we spoke about wearing masks. indoor public places that are crowded, poorly ventilated, mask use is another great idea, and it's another layer of protection. So again, thanks for joining us, and thanks for all the questions. I think we got a lot of great great issues out there today.
Thank you, Dr. Rusin, and thank you both, and also thank you, Manitobans who connected into tonight. We had, I believe, a really good turnout. I'm just looking quickly at some stats, and I think it was, and the questions are obviously a judge of some really high level of interest. Not surprising, our kids, when our kids are involved, and I think it's great that this opportunity was presented. And you asked some good questions, and thank you, Dr. Doyle and Dr. Rusin, providing some really good advice and answers. There was really good information shared. I know Dr. Doyle talked about some good websites. I know kidcare.mb.ca is a good one too for a resource for parents to find some information. I hope you'll be able to visit some of these and able to take away as you care for your family in the days and weeks ahead. And on that, good night, everyone, and have a good rest of your evening.